Since this is the week of St. Patrick's Day, we thought we would share some thoughts on being Irish. I remember my days back in New York and the many St. Patrick's Day parades I marched in both in high school and college, and the parties afterwards. The celebrations still continue right here in California through today and through St. Patrick's Day. Stay tuned as we share some thoughts for St. Patrick's Day week.
Welcome to The Better Part, a program that encompasses a diverse spectrum of topics important to our community, which we hope will both inform and entertain you. We invite you to sit back and enjoy the program.
Hello, I'm Phil Lenihan, first generation Irish American of The Better Part. Today we have two Irish guests, Norman Patrick Doyle, scholar, traveler, photographer, and a longtime friend and partner in a few Irish adventures. And also he was born in Ireland, making him a true Irishman. And Michael James Fallon, instructor at both Mission College and San Jose State, and author of the book, The Definitive St. Patrick's Day Festivities Book. Welcome, gentlemen. Welcome to The Better Part. Norman, let's start with you, since you're the only real Irishman in the crew. What is it like growing up in Ireland as a kid? And I hear you had some adventures as a child actor.
Well, growing up in Ireland is different for different people. If the only thing you knew about it was Angela's Ashes, you might have a very grim picture of it. I look back on my childhood, and first of all, it went by in a blur. And second of all, I was happy most of the time. I had a loving family. I had a superb education. I still think of it that way today, even though it was at the hands of the Christian Brothers, who have not gotten good press over the last few years. And I think I was equipped by all of the above for everything that happened after that. The child actor thing that you mentioned came about because my cousin, Brenda Fricker, whom you may have heard of, was a child actor on Radio Éireann, the national radio station back in Ireland. And they had one girl and one boy, and these two played all the girl roles, all the boy roles for children in the various plays and things that were being done. The boy's voice broke, so he was out of a job. And they said to my cousin, "Do you know anyone that could fill in for Jim?" And she said, "Well, my cousin Norman." So I went in, they tried me out, and I got the job. And I was a child actor on national radio until my voice broke.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Was that RVE?
RTE.
RTE.
Right.
What schools did you go to?
I went to St. Fintan's High School in Sutton. That was the high school that I went mm-hmm. to. And then I graduated from the College of Advanced Technology in Dublin with a degree in electrical engineering.
And why did you leave Ireland?
Phil, I graduated in the early 60s when in those days there may have been, let's say, because the Irish university system has always been very good, let's say there were 10,000 graduates, there might have been, on a good day, 1,000 jobs for them. So you got your degree in one hand and a boat ticket in the other hand. There wasn't too much choice in those days.
Well, I too had the Irish Christian Brothers in high school. And the little straps, I remember those.
Oh yes, the straps.
Michael, tell us what it's like growing up in Toledo as an Irishman.
Well, I grew up in a diverse neighborhood with as many Polish and Germans as Irish. I don't remember anything special other than our celebration of St. Patrick's Day. But I did take a certain pride in being Irish because I would like to say that my great-grandfather, Richard O'Fallon, had a drayage business, and he hauled a lot of the construction materials from the Maumee River up the hill for the construction of St. Patrick's Cathedral. So whenever we would look up at St. Patrick's Cathedral, I knew that that was my heritage, and that my grandfather himself who had built it. When I became of the drinking age, I probably had a few St. Patrick's days at Sean's back door out in the St. Patrick's of Heatherdown's Parish, but that was pretty much the extent of my knowledge of being Irish growing up in Toledo.
All right. Norman, would you like to share with us the parties that we used to produce called Silicon Valley Grand Hoolies?
Grand Hoolies, they were the days. They started, as you remember, when we were raising funds for radio station we were working on in Los Gatos. And the first one was at
Mountain Charlie's.
No, that was the second one. The first one was Specs. Is it?
Oh, yeah.
What is it? The place. Anyway, never mind.
Yeah.
So the second one was Mountain Charlie's. Second and third, I think, were Mountain Charlie's. And the thing just grew. It took on a life of its own. We basically were not in control anymore. And I think we did it for
14
years. And we would have, how would you describe?
We'd have 800 of our closest friends.
Yeah, that's right. All of whom claimed Irish ancestry. And we would have a variety of acts, pipers, fiddlers, excellent musicians, groups. We'd have generally the high point of the evening, because the high point normally occurs after a considerable consumption of alcohol. The high point of the evening every time was the Los Trancos Woods Community Marching Band.
Our indoor St. Patrick's Day Parade.
Exactly. The band would parade down the aisle of whatever unfortunate establishment we had taken over, and the audience would rise to their feet, and it was quite a moment. Uh-huh. It was quite a moment.
And we had a wake.
We would have another standard feature each time was a casket that was piped in by Phil, carried by some pallbearers that we had pressed into service, and nobody ever knew what was going to be in the casket each year.
Ah.
We had a belly dancer. We had a leprechaun.
We had Norman dressed in drag, imitating the Queen of England when she came to visit Stanford University.
I did a really good
with
Queen
his little purse hanging there. Yeah. Huh.
Yes, and those were 14 good ones.
14 good ones, and we stopped at the top.
We did. We left them wanting more.
That's the only way out.
I'm sure many have heard the Irish joke that the only difference between an Irish wedding and an Irish wake is one less Irishman.
That's true. Okay, let's talk about your book. How did you ever get started in writing a book about how to celebrate St. Patrick's Day?
It all goes back to a time that I was staying at home with my family in 1975, and as I said, having had nothing but traditional Irish dinners on St. Patrick's Day, my sister, 3 years younger than myself, and I decided that we were really going to celebrate St. Patrick's Day in grand fashion to honor my father and our Irish heritage. So we set out several weeks in advance to begin to research what would constitute a great Irish party, a ceilidh, a cruinniú, a gathering of family and friends. And so we visited for quite a number of days the Toledo public libraries and researched the Irish. And we came up with a variety of folklore, skits, limericks, and then just sat down and began to put all of these together. We had a very successful St. Patrick's Day party on a Tuesday night with relatives that came as far away from Detroit to Toledo that raged until 2 or 3 a.m. in the morning, much like your Hoolies, it sounds. And so we knew that we really had a winner here. As a teacher, then I began on St. Patrick's Day to use many of these same activities in my lesson plans. Finally, in 1995, I was substitute teaching at St. Francis High School in Mountain View, California. And as a substitute teacher, knowing the challenge of getting students to pay attention, I said, I think what would really save the day would be to share a lot of my St. Patrick's Day activities with them. And so I had very successful lesson plans throughout the day, and I came home and I said, if this was so successful for me today, and if I've had such successful parties using these activities, should I not put this into a book and share it with others, particularly with educators and other folks that attempt to put on St. Patrick's Day dinners and St. Patrick's Day parties? And again, what I was really attempting to do in the book is that so many Americans, in fact, people around the world, celebrate St. Patrick's Day, and yet they know so little of Ireland and St. Patrick other than green beer and corned beef cabbage. And so the subtitle of the book is to enhance the celebration of the Irish in us all and bring at least a little education of the great saint and the wonderful Irish tradition to our celebrations on March 17th.
But I read the book, and it's endless wonderful stuff.
Thank you.
Some of which you wrote yourself, obviously.
Yes.
It's your book. Where did you find that, by just doing research before a St. Patrick's Day or over a couple of years?
No, I would say for the most part it was a one-shot deal where we really amassed a great deal of ideas, and they all came together that night. Over the course of, again, teaching and then using those activities at other parties, They grew and I added to it. And I think when I actually wrote the final copy of the book in 94, 95, that I actually did a little more research.
Have you tried all the recipes in the book in the food section?
I've tried most of them. I think what I'm proud of is to recognize that there are different qualities of corned beef, and that you can cook a really nice corned beef other than just boiling it in water with some carrots and some cabbage. Last year I put a corned beef, a nice brisket, in a crock pot early in the morning, poured a couple cans of Guinness Drought over the top of it, and when I came home that evening, it was the most mouth-watering corned beef that I had had in a long time.
Oh. I thought you were going to say you threw the corned beef out and drank the Guinness.
I really loved the sauce. I lapped that up equally with the potatoes and the carrots and the cabbage.
And you gathered all the graphics at the same time?
That was an interesting story. I had a publishing company, a newly formed publishing company, really lock onto the book. They actually thought that this book would be a great sale through the Guinness Network. They envisioned selling 10,000 copies of this book. And so I actually made a trip to Guinness with a suitcase, an old Navy suitcase with like some 32 books in it, and was giving them away freely, hoping that Guinness would buy these 10,000 books. But I didn't land a sale with Guinness, and in the short time before the book actually took off, excuse me, I need to go back in time a little bit here, the company folded. It never went off the ground. I was fortunate enough to have had a copy ready, camera ready, copy for print, and so at that point in time, I joined up with a co-publishing company, the Jenkins Group out of Michigan, and co-published the book, and that's where I went back to Guinness, and that's when I then attempted to sell it on my own, since we did not have an early take from Guinness based upon the manuscript itself.
Ah, and who is Sister Michael Ann Mike Murphy, who wrote your preface?
Sister Michael Ann Murphy is a delightful sister of the Presentation of the Blessed Virgin Mary. She is the principal of St. John Vianney Elementary School in East San Jose. Beloved principal, she's been there some 30 years, and being obviously of Irish stock, she was absolutely insistent that upon St. Patrick's Days, all of her teaching staff wore Irish hats. And if you did not provide your own, she would come around and furnish you with an Irish hat, which she expected you to have on in the classroom all day through.
Well, the book covers limericks, sweepstakes, which are what?
That's my title, chapter title for a variety of activities, games, as you said, most of which perhaps I created from what I had researched.
And you also have shenanigans and limericks?
Yes, yes. Again, I tried to give a good sampling of what is common to people and yet not well known, and little verses and little jigs that could be used on St. Patrick's Day as they interact with others.
And where did you get the skits? Did you write some of those yourself?
Most of those I wrote myself, yes.
Have
yes.
you used them at a party?
Yes, I have. And it's always wonderful after people have had some Guinness and some Irish whiskey to see how they interpret some of these lines. Some of the most childish, innocent verses were very interestingly interpreted by some of my male and female adults.
Well, it's a fun book. Good. I read it. I may actually read it again. I have bent down a couple of pages and so now, you would like to read a little section from the book?
I have selected a section.
Okay.
You and Norman Patrick spoke of St. Patrick's Day parades in
yes.
New York and
yes.
at your Hoolies. And so I selected a section from Intonations, where I tried to just give a general feel and tone of what it is to be Irish, and again, some of the folklore and the jokes. And so this one is called St. Patrick's Day Parade: Participants in Controversy. I created this as if it were an article on the Top of the Morning Times from Dublin, Ireland. If I may take out my reading glasses. It seems everyone knows what's best for the St. Patrick's Day parade, but no one knows what's best for all the participants. The Faith in Begora Christian group objects to the liberated ladies of Hibernia's entry, Erin Gobralis. The ladies, in turn, resent the Gaelic fellows carrying their shillelaghs in hand, fearing that someone will get poked. The friendly sons of St. Patrick, in a spirit of compromise, offer to parade in paddy wagons to keep the peace. Tinkering with the tradition, the Tinker's Caravan was aligned second to last because of the high pitch of their tin whistles, while McNamara's band objects to marching behind the Tinkers with their large number of horses, ponies, and dogs. The city mayor commented, St. Patrick, help us.
I learned in my days in the marching band never to get yourself positioned behind an equestrian unit.
Exactly.
That's true, unless they come with their little scoop of kids.
Yes, and so few of them do these days, yes. Phil.
Norman, you've done some research on the Irish in the Civil War. Can you tell us something about that and John Riley?
Yes, it's something something that I sort of fell into. I was for a time a Civil War reenactor, and I served proudly in Company B of the 69th New York Volunteer Infantry, which was an all-Irish unit in
the Fighting Irish.
The Fighting Irish, exactly. Mm-hmm. You may have seen the movie. And they still exist today, in fact. Last I heard, they were posted to Iraq. This got me interested, and I started reading the history of the Irish Brigade in the Civil War, which was founded by Thomas Francis Marr. And Thomas Francis Marr was one of the Young Irelanders, one of the 1848 Irish, another failed Irish rebellion. He was one of the leaders of that and was sent to Tasmania for life imprisonment, from which he escaped, obviously. Fascinating character, very, very interesting history. So I got really involved in that, and I've written some on Marr and on the Irish Brigade. And then you mentioned John Riley. That John Riley was an immigrant from Ireland who served in the U.S. Army during the Mexican War. And he and many of his fellow countrymen deserted, joined the Mexican side, and fought as the San Patricio Battalion against the Union Army. It's a fascinating story. Again, it has been made into a movie that didn't get a lot of circulation. And there are a number of books that touch on the topic, but not a lot is known about them. The fact that approximately 400 Irishmen basically deserted the U.S. Army and fought on the Mexican side in 1946-7-8. And John Riley himself is something of a mystery man. I'm still trying to figure out his whole story.
Trying to find out where he went after he left Mexico.
Where did he go when he rose to be a major in the Mexican Army, and he was demobilized in, he mustered out in, I believe, 1850 with a fairly reasonable sum of money and disappeared off the face of the earth.
Ah.
It was a coincidence that one of my students at San Jose State, Mexican American, actually did a research paper himself on the San Patricios, which I read and would be happy to share with you. But he did say that the Irish, knowing what oppression was at both the hands of the British, when they came to the Southwest and they saw how the United States government was itself oppressing the Mexicans that lived in that region, that they were very sympathetic and again felt that they had reason to support their cause. Would you say that that was fairly accurate?
No, I wouldn't.
No?
No. They never came to the Southwest. What was happening was that there was a great deal of discrimination in the U.S. forces against immigrants and against Irish in particular and against Irish Catholics in particular.
All right.
And so it was a cruel, brutal existence for infantrymen. Mm-hmm. The officers all tended to be West Point Episcopalians, mm-hmm. and the punishments that were handed out, such as flogging and branding, were pretty bad. And there's considerable evidence that it was discrimination, that if you were Irish or Catholic or both, the Germans also suffered, the German Catholics, you would be punished far more severely than anybody else would be. So then the Mexicans started sending pamphlets across the Rio Grande saying, mm-hmm. hey, why are you making war on your fellow religionists? You know, come and join us and help to make things better, and we'll give you land, and we'll give you, you know, a position in our forces and all the rest of it. And so this is very, very attractive to some of these guys who are being so badly treated.
Mm-hmm.
And
and led to massive desertions. There were more desertions in the Mexican-American War than in any other war that the United States has fought.
Interesting. Now, you were down in Mexico and saw one of the local celebrations of the San Patricios.
This was a real surprise. The Mexican-American War essentially finished with the Battle of Churubusco, the monastery in Mexico City, which was defended by the San Patricios. And so on a vacation in Mexico City, this was one place that I wanted to go to. So they've turned the old monastery into this museum of all of the countries that intervened in Mexico, the British, the French, the Spanish, the Americans, they're all commemorated in this museum. And there's a special remembrance of the San Patricios with their names and a very nice little memorial. So as my wife and I are leaving this place, I can hear bagpipe music out in the courtyard outside. And when I go out, here's a whole group of Mexican reenactors practicing for an annual event that they were to have the following week, which is a reenactment of the Battle of Churubusco. And they were all taking on the role of San Patricios. I was just absolutely blown away by this thing. It was marvelous.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
I've seen some of their clips on YouTube, and they're very good. Mm. Norman, you spent 3 years in Hong Kong. How is the Irish community in Hong Kong, and how do they celebrate St. Patrick's Day in Hong Kong?
Well, you know, the Irish community there was a highlight of our stay in Hong Kong. I was there for work, obviously, but I very quickly joined the St. Patrick's Society of Hong Kong, which is a group of people with vague, tenuous Irish connections. Actually, there were quite a few genuine Irish people in it. Okay. And the thing is an excuse to get together on a fairly regular basis and just have a really good time. They would have a St. Patrick's Day dinner and dance, which is kind of formal. They would do things like a barbecue on one of the outer islands where we'd all go out by boat and have this wonderful barbecue. They had a Bloomsday event, which was the best I've ever seen. You may have been to the one in San Francisco in the Holy Ground.
No.
Okay, that's also very good, but this one was magnificent, and there were various people doing readings from Ulysses, and the last one was this woman who did Molly Bloom's soliloquy, the famous soliloquy, and there wasn't a dry seat in the house. It was just fantastic. If I may, one other thing that was an annual event for the St. Patrick Society of Hong Kong was the annual curry dinner at the Central Police Station. Now, the Central Police Station in Hong Kong was built by the British back in the Victorian era, and it's this gaunt granite pile that rises up over Wan Chai and glares down at the people. And so once a year, the St. Patrick Society of Hong Kong would have this curry dinner in the officers' mess. And you'd go up this long cobbled ramp up into a courtyard with cannons and a flagpole and a veranda all around, and you'd go in the mess, and the Indian liveried servants would serve you curry and beverages of your choice and so on and so forth. So I was just, again, absolutely amazed at this. And I said to the president of the society, Ian Shaw, I think his name was, he was a judge. I said, Ian, how does the St. Patrick's Society get to use this magnificent facility? And he said, come with me. And he led me down these flights of stairs from the mess into the great lobby of the Central Police Station with its high ceiling and its, you know, stone floors and the big desk where the booking sergeant sat. And on the wall behind the booking sergeant was this list of all the police commissioners from 1841. And it was Byrne, Murphy, Doyle, O'Hanrahan. And he said, do you have any further questions?
Oh, sounds like fun.
Yes, it was.
Michael, we had an assignment for both of you, actually, including me. What was the most Irish thing you've ever done?
The most Irish thing I've ever done? Is that aside from practicing Roman Catholicism or being religious about Guinness and Irish whiskey? It's probably tinkering around Ireland with my father, having pints of Guinness for lunch in pubs, and going to banquet dinners at Bunratty Castle, and probably for me individually, because my father could not master this, but I climbed Crow Patrick.
Wow.
in the early misty morning, and to have been up there on the top of Crow Patrick by myself, knowing that it is a pilgrimage for many Irish mm-hmm. to have made annually, was probably one of the highlights of my two trips to Ireland.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful.
Norman.
I have not climbed Crow Patrick.
I see. Have you done anything ridiculous that we get to discuss on the air?
Well, you didn't say ridiculous. You said the most Irish thing.
The most Irish, okay.
Now, the true answer, the one I'd like to give, is ridiculous, but it takes too much time and it involves a team of Mexican furniture movers. And we literally don't have time for
okay.
it. But so I think the most Irish thing I've ever done is to emigrate. Because that was a very Irish thing. And in the time when I did emigrate, it was a vast tide of people, usually graduates, and not always, just washing out of Ireland, going across the world and adding to the Irish communities in Toledo and other places.
Yes.
As we know, with the increase in prosperity during the years of the Celtic Tiger, that tide reversed itself, and more mm-hmm. people actually came back to Ireland than left, which was a wonderful thing. Mm-hmm. So that was, it's a boring answer, but that's the most Irish thing I ever did.
Well, mine is not as great as either of yours, but for my 75th birthday, I had an Irish bracelet tattooed on my ankle. And it matches my wedding ring. Thank you, gentlemen, for joining us today in our celebration of St. Patrick's Day week. And we hope you and everybody watching has a safe and sound St. Patrick's Day.
Hear, hear.
Well, that's it for another program. Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Norman. We'll see you again next week. And remember, as they say in Ireland, and this is one that I've picked up, if you want your dreams to come true, don't oversleep. See you next week.
'Thank you for joining us. We hope that you found today's program both informative and interesting. If you would like to suggest a topic or a guest for The Better Part, you can always reach us at the Cupertino Senior Center. The number there is 408-777-3150. You can learn more about us and order a copy of this program or one of the many programs that we've done by visiting our website. The website address is www.thebetterpart.com. The Better Part has many of its programs available through the Santa Clara County Library System. And The Better Part has selected programs also on YouTube. Thanks again for watching. See you next week.